image of the three worlds is really attempting to move the earth. So what that's the mouth, which indicates a certain amount of aggression. And that's probably not something to put on a child's kindergarten or this is made out of steel and fiberglass. Now, most everything in this room I did by hand. I sculpted this. I didn't sculpt for this thing, but I asked them to help. They didn't sculpt it, I sculpted it. But I didn't sand and polish it for months and months. It's got 8 coats of clear on it. It was hand polished between each coat. This thing is lined with steel. I'll tell you how this thing's made. I did a drawing in 3 different positions, very beneficial, and I took it to a fabrication house called Joe's Home. And I sat down with a fellow at the computer for 2 weeks, and he took my drawing in 3 different positions and calculated it up to 360 degrees of ground. And I sat there and said, "Oh, that is now you change this position." Okay, the next step is that computer information is put into a 3D printer. So the 3D printer takes about a 14-inch copy of this thing for information. So I'm looking at it, a lot of mistakes are not good. So then I can bring those mistakes and the computer scans the information to put back in the computer. Now, Jeff Coons, when he's open, I'll tell you how this is done. Okay, from that point, they get big foam blocks of foam, and they take a CNC machine, which is a machine that cuts, and that computer information is put in that CNC machine. And then this thing just starts cutting. And it takes days and weeks for this machine cutting it. And it's done in sections. So it's not cut in one big piece, it's cut in a lot of little sections. So then all the sections are glued together, and there's some real problems that to begin with, the computer couldn't calculate the key. So I had to carve 192 keys. The other problem was, this thing is kind of like an oval shape like it's in motion. So it's way off balance looking, but this dust cloud back here is full of weight, hundreds of pounds in its tail to justify that big length. Now, after this thing is perked out, the foam is made perfect, and then the hard coat is perfect, and then that's perfect. Then after we have this thing looking exactly like the one, we take it to a fabricator, he gets a saw, cuts it into little bit pieces. And then after the little bit pieces are cut, then female molds. And then out of those female molds, we put the fiberglass to put together, and then a steel structure in place. And then we start. All along the way, there's always made the problem. And the major problems fall on me. So, there's a question was, is the dust clouds going to look like dust clouds, or are they going to look like feces? No one's ever done dust clouds before. So, when we painted it, I had blue and ochre painted spots in it, so it would have a sense of transparency as it just does. Now, the steel sections are break loose off the side of that dust cloud, and this whole thing lifts up out here with a fork. So, engineering this thing was really hitting this thing and putting it together and fitting it many times. The computer could not handle it. So, it's just a matter of running whatever this thing looks like. So, I'd like you to know the enormous amount of sweat and tears running in the same thing, just take care of it. those that were just done on top, that's their old staff.
How many, George?
There's a question of the taste here, as an architect. Well, I'll be frank with you. Art like this cannot exist if you don't get rid of sophistication. The element of sophistication is really cramped the style of it. Here, if you look at this form of art as a visual expression for a very small audience, I'm not Thomas Kincaid. Out of exploratory imagination, I'm going to miss all the people. Your pastor will not appreciate this picture. And you have to understand that the origin of these paintings have a deeper and more legitimate origin than fine art, because these are related to comic books, and being movie books, and a lot of salacious stuff that the fine arts world doesn't feel like brand new foods. So, when you come in here and you deal with all this stuff, it just lacks that sophistication. I've heard it said, well, I like this stuff, but I wouldn't want it on my wall. Yeah, you're right, and I'll tell you why. Because I think oil painting and art in general should be able to stand out as literature. And all you have a coffee table with a nice house. And on your coffee table, you've got literature, you've got the table of two cities, 3 years before the mass, or at least. And it comes to books for the educated. But you don't open those books up. You don't see the guillotine cutting people's heads off. Table of two cities. Well, and art should be just as legitimate as literature, and you have just as much of a voice. Lowly cartoons, have a larger visual vocabulary than any other form of art. Any other. If you can think it, you can see it with cartoons. But it does lack that Bauhaus. But unfortunately, I appeal to collectors that can understand the heritage of these paintings and whatnot. When you realize that comic books have such an effect on American culture, that they're a big thing. Movies, television, the internet. It's just a wide vocabulary. I'll go to a lecture and things go far. They'll stick me in the literature department because of the comics. Now, my comic book background is from the underground of the 60s. I was fortunate enough to be one of the Zap comic book artists. And I was allowed the privilege of dipping into some pretty gratuitous material. In other words, with that comics, you had the ability to express yourself as wildly, as strongly as you can. And we did that. And this got 300 or 400 people in.